give thanks to love and for the offering contained within these plates that allows us to live out our values together beyond these walls as well as within them, even now as our lights are running. We give thanks as well for the offering of your service and the sharing of individual gifts to sound something beautiful. For that offering which overflows the plates, we say. Confess something. I figure after last week and appearing in a chicken costume after the Easter service, there's proof on Facebook for any of you who missed it, that I needed to just come out with all of it at once and not drag this out and give you my last secret. Are you ready? You ready? Ready? I promise it's not too foul. and it shouldn't ruffle too many You see, when I began attending a Unitarian Universalist congregation, I remember my first Sunday as if it were yesterday. Maybe some of you have that recollection, too, who weren't raised UU. Do you remember your first Sunday? Mine was in upstate New York, in Rochester, and as I pulled into the parking lot, something was very apparent from the outset. There were pre-I gathered. And on each car, nearly at each and every single one, there was some kind of bumper sticker, many a coexist bumper sticker. Anyone have coexist bumper stickers here? It's okay to admit, I'm not gonna mock. Yes, okay. As I walked in to the congregation that morning, I happened to glance down and I looked round to see so many pairs of Birkenstocks. It was like a communion. I sat down, looking around and watching all of the folks who had their reusable coffee mugs in their hands, ready for the service. And then, of course, the service included a couple of Wendell Berry quotes and a few Mary Oliver poems. In fact, I got my share of Mary Oliver's anthology, I think, in the first 6 months of attending that congregation. At the newcomer class, though, was where I started to get a little worried. We were invited to simply check in around what our week had been like, what had we been up to, and it was just a beautiful spring in upstate New York after a very long winter. They're always long, but this was a really long one. And person after person started sharing how they'd been hiking, how they'd gone camping, how they'd been out to the lake to see the beauty of spring and nature and how they just reveled in it. And I started to feel myself shifting in my heels. Thing is, I love nature in the abstract. And I fear that I might be a bit of a heretic to this faith in this regard, because the closest I come to camping of my own volition is what my wife calls glamping. I love a good hotel room with a view. Up close, nature makes me kind of itch and twitch and sneeze. I've backpacked my way into the desert, I've seen natural wonders, I've pitched a tent all over this country of ours. I've gotten dirty and even not showered for 2 days. I left my hair dryer at home once and my makeup in the car, but I didn't touch it. Perhaps it is sheer vanity or a lack of spiritual evolution, but I have concluded that I am not of the hiking, backpacking variety of UU. And yet I know there is truth in the natural world. There is wisdom in the earth. Frank Lloyd Wright, the architect and Unitarian, once noted, "I believe in God, only I spell it N-A-T-U-R-E. Unitarian Universalism, we are a diverse faith, but there seems to be one thing that we do agree upon. There is vital wisdom to be drawn from this blue boat home. As our transcendentalist ancestors, many of whom were Unitarians, Ralph Waldo Emerson, Margaret Fuller, Henry David Thoreau, as they tell us, we need no intermediary for truth or God. No, she can be found in the experience of the natural world. And such truth, such an experience is direct, it is imminent. It transcends all of the things we could put in the way. We are a faith grounded in an affirmation and promotion of the interdependent web of all existence, of which we are a very small part. Now, this view of creation, at least for me, is different than the creation stories that I was raised with. Creation, growing up in the religious school I attended, was one of two stories, one in which chaos needed to be ordered, light and dark separated. And the other creation story, where Adam and Eve were sent to earth as a punishment, being kicked out of the garden. In each story, though, man is commanded to name and to control the wild things, to tame the earth. This, of course, is not the only way of understanding the spiritual nature of creation. In South Dakota, when defending the pipeline, I found it curious, I don't know if any of y'all did either, but when the South Dakota Sioux talked about what they were doing and why they were doing it, they called themselves what? Does anybody remember?
Water protectors.
I can't help but believe that this is connected to one of their creation myths. One of their creation myths is where turtle goes deep into the waters, kind of the abyss, and she swims all the way down to the bottom and gets some mud. She brings the mud back up and puts it on her back, and that's the formation of earth. The first bit of land is this swimming turtle with mud on her back. Now, this is the second creation in the Lakota narrative of creation. The first one having been destroyed because the people were led astray. And so in this story of creation, man is not given dominion over the earth, but rather a very humble place balancing on the back of a turtle, to be a protector of that creature which provides them life. You see how this changes our relationship and our understanding. Naomi Klein reminds us of this truth this morning in our quote, that we are not in fact in control, able to tame the earth. In fact, she could send us flying at any minute with a flood, a fire, a quake, all manner of things. In the words of the eco-spiritualist Starhawk, the crone, the reaper, she is the dark moon which you don't see coming at you. Chance, you could say, the wind that whips the spark across the fire line. Chance, or what's scarier still, the intersection of chance with choice and actions made before. The brush that is tinder dry from decades of drought, the warming of the Earth's climate that sends the storms away north, the hole in the ozone layer, not punishment, not even justice, but consequence. Consequence. I want to return you for a moment to that story of the Garden of Eden, of which many of us are familiar. So picture it, right? We're typically told that the snake, a serpent of evil, comes into the garden and whispers things in Adam's and Eve's ears, and often Eve is given the blame, right, for taking the bite and having the idea. It's all her fault. And then they are expelled from the garden by an angry God and sent to earth. But I'd like to propose this day an alternative version, if you will, an older version. If we consider the ancient times, the snake represented fertility, life herself. And so as I pass around this snake skin, it's not a real living snake, it is a real snake skin. I want you just to listen to this version of the story. The snake skin was given to me as a parting gift from my previous congregation, infer what you will. And the snake who it belongs to had shed her skin by rubbing her body up against the rough brick foundation of our congregation, and so she left this massive and beautiful snake skin. And because you're smiling, I'm going to hand it to you first.
I am smiling.
So in this version, let us imagine we are in the Garden of Eden, and there are Adam and Eve, and they've been talking, and I want you to imagine with me, if you will, that the snake's been coming around for a few weeks now, and the snake has her own opinions. She really thinks that God treats Adam and Eve just like children. For heaven's sakes, they don't even know to wear clothes, and winter is coming. How are they going to take care of themselves? And so the snake, she is fertility and she is life, and this young, consciously coupled pair, without children, are getting a little nervous every time they see this symbol of fertility coming around them. It's understandable. They might even fear her a little bit because she knows that, they know that she could bring life-altering changes. And so the snake keeps coming by, and one day the snake says to Eve, Eve, listen, you know that tree that God said don't go near? Well, that tree, it has a fruit, it's called an apple, and that fruit is the very fruit of knowledge. It is love, an experience that you have never had. And once you have it, sweet girl, everything's gonna change. Do what you will, says the snake. And the snake's words, they have a way of worming their way into Eve's mind. And she can't quite let it go. And she even tells Adam, look at the snake. She told me that tree, that God has that gate around, and that he said, don't ever touch. She said that is the tree of something called love, and there's something called an apple, and if I bite the apple, I'm going to know something I've never known before. And Adam, I've got to know more than this garden because it's boring. And he starts rubbing his hip like he always does just to make her feel bad. I don't know, Eve, says Adam. So it's late one night, and Adam's gone to bed right at 8:30 like he always does. But Eve, she can't quite sleep. And so she's pacing in that garden, looking at that tree. Finally, she gets up the courage and she walks straight up to the tree and she climbs over that protective gate and she plucks an apple. It's lighter than she thought it would be. She takes a look at it, brings it to her lips. never know.
By this time, Adam's awake, and he's looking kind of terrified at her. Like, what have you done? But she is in exhilaration. This is knowledge. This is the world. And so she tosses it to him. Says, take a bite, Adam. So he does. And they know. They know it all, right? And Eve looks down and goes, winter's coming and I'm not wearing clothes. And so they put some clothes on, and that's when God gets there. God walks in. Oh, okay. God's angry. But really, God's just worried. He's still getting used to this God thing. He's not so good at it all the time. And so he lets his anger take over for his fear, because really, he knows what love is and will be for them. That it will be joy and exhilaration, and it will be heartbreak and sorrow. And that's something that you can't unknow. And so God, getting all angry, says, get out. Just get out. And so they do. And they leave so quickly that the snake, she doesn't have a chance to tell them the one thing that she should have told them, which is that there's something about the bite of living and loving. And that's the consequence. And this story gets all sort of not right with the ancestors of Adam and Eve. Eve gets blamed, and then somebody writes down the version. And they don't know the truth of their origin, and so they spend an evolution or two feeling bad, letting shame fill their lives, trying to consume everything they can to match that first bite described by their great-grandmother Eve. They are reckless, and the consequences build up to this day. From the divisive political landscape, to the constant pace of email and social media, to the painful conversation right now within our denomination about racism, I feel this churning within me almost every morning that I wake up and carry through my day. And sometimes it makes me just want to bite back. Does anybody else want to bite back sometimes? I mean, just be honest. It's just us and whoever's watching. And then sometimes I just want to numb this anxiety that I feel. I want to listen to this consumer culture that tells me somehow stuff is going to solve it. You know, it's kind of trite now to speak of the consumerist world, and yet its power is so pervasive. It places expediency and perfection over savoring and learning. It's a culture that prizes the new and favors control, order, and hierarchy. Mm-hmm. It has become the water that we swim in. I've begun to try, despite my aversion to camping, to develop an earth consciousness that centers and clarifies consequence. Not to shame myself, but to live with an awareness, a growing awareness that disrupts this consumerist consumption theology. Because I don't want to be distracted anymore. I don't want to be tied to my devices and to a pace that is not one of the earth's pace. I'm learning that it's impossible to live without some consequence. We all are going to have some consequence, but the question is, can we discover ways to live with beauty and brilliance that defy this false theology? So what is an earth consciousness that centers consequence? I believe it to be a reorientation to time, to place, to purpose. Time. The fast pace of social media and the news can drive a misdirected sense of urgency.
But when you sit before a mountain or at the edge of the ocean, or if you are to watch, as one of our members has, the process of an egg becoming a bird in a nest. Has anyone ever gotten to do this, maybe somewhere in the eave of your house? Or watch a little sapling over the years that you painted for, that you planted for a child, grow into a tree. We get an understanding of what the ancients called Kairos time, that is sacred time, in opposition to Chronos time, which is the time that can be calculated. And when we reorient our lives to Kairos time instead of Chronos time, there's a new urgency that emerges, and it's not about can we come up with something to say in the next tweet or post, but it is an urgency to be considering the impact, our consequence, not one generation from now, but seven generations from now. Listen to the stories of someone near the end of their life. They've never said, I really regretted I didn't get to that last email. They don't, right? Instead, they wish for more Kairos time with their loved ones. They long for one more sunset, one more moment of Earth's majesty. Earth consciousness also requires a reorientation to place, to understanding that we are on this turtle back in a delicate kind of balancing act to live in this world, to take what we need, but no more. Centering ourselves to place also begins to help us understand exactly where do all the things that make our life possible come from. Having 2-year-olds is a wonderful practice in this. My son, every time he takes a bath, says, as the water drains out, where'd the water go? And I explain into the pipe, but that is not sufficient. We've even visited the basement to watch the pipes. And then where? I guess it goes to another pipe outside the house. And then where? I guess it goes to a water treatment plant. And then where? And on it goes. I don't think about the water coming out the faucet. But we're tuned to do that as little children, to be curious about all the things that sustain our lives. And we can cultivate that kind of earth consciousness again, to sit down when we have a meal and consider all the ways in which someone else or something else made that meal possible. Again, not out of shame, but out of an awareness that develops a humility that changes the decisions we make with an awareness of the consequences they carry. And last, purpose. As the off-key lover of all things Minnesota and regular critic of Unitarian Universalism, Garrison Keillor, notes, cats are intended to teach us that not everything in nature has a purpose. I love cats for the cat lovers. But perhaps we could add to Mr. Keillor's words, not everything in nature has a purpose for us humans. It is a relief to know that at last not everything hinges on us, nor can we control everything, but really only the small measure of our own consequence. When we lean into this purpose, we know that our accomplishments and our very being really only matter insofar as they strengthen the entire web, not our own ego. This is the work of a lifetime, to see the strands in the web, to begin to live in to interdependence with a humility of consequence, to take the long view. I close with the words of the poet Leah Tonino in her poem, Write-Ins,
for president. I elect that bull elk in the Snake River. I elect that raven in Canyonlands National Park. I elect autumn moonlight on metal roofs. I elect my neighbor's cat. The neighbors who are always cursing one another and screaming hateful things, because every morning that cat sits with me on the fire escape and watches the sun rise without meowing. I elect the ghost of my grandfather, Dean, because the man never wanted to be anything but a farmer, said my grandmother, Betty. I elect my grandmother, Betty, because at 95, she takes the long view. I elect the hungry mouse who stole my snack, but did so honestly, out in the open. I elect the thump, thump, thump of many wagging tails. I elect a precarious peak that made me and will forever keep me humble as a pebble. And I elect that which can't be written in, that which will guide us forever, ever forward, regardless of who lives in some white house.